as far as like publishing, how it ranks as a revenue stream for recording artists, if the artist actually writes their songs and doesn't have other writers writing all their parts of it, and they get percentages of these songs, if these songs become top 10 singles in the Hot 100, they could potentially live off of that money for the rest of their lives. A top 10 Hot 100 single has very high value, and there will always be performance income, streaming income, and mechanical income generated from those records. Plus, as a popular top 10 single, you have more of a chance of getting more synchronization opportunities. And this income could be substantial, and it's money you'll have for the rest of your life that's accounted to you via your publisher, or if you're collecting directly, you're getting your statements directly, but it's very substantial. I would definitely put publishing in the top three of most important income out there for songwriters and for recording artists that actually write their songs, and producers as well. Outside of music publishing, I would say touring and merchandise is the most important revenue income streams that are out there for artists. You know, you got to remember, songwriters, the producers behind the scenes, they might not be touring as much as an artist. You know, I mean, you have your Metro Boomins and Mike Wills that actually go on the road and do big tours, but a lot of producers don't in hip hop and R&B. So, you know, and then a lot of them don't have merchandise as well. You know, they're not doing much merch or anything like that. So the key income that they're getting are their royalties for producers. The music publishing business has changed drastically over the years, and that streaming income and performance income are pretty much the higher income that you receive these days, whereas mechanical royalties from record sales are lower than what they used to be. When I first started in music publishing, physical units were still very much a big part of music distribution, and people would go out and buy CDs still. And those mechanical royalty checks from the major labels and from labels selling CDs were significantly higher than what mechanical royalty checks are today in the music business, in the music publishing business. It all starts with album equivalent units and streaming as well. Album equivalent units are everything bundled into one: your streams, your YouTube views, your digital downloads, all into one, which then create one sale or one album, one single sale or one album sale. Per the RIAA, 1,500 streams of one song can equal 10 tracks, which then equals one album. And so this gets very complicated when you have an album that comes out that has a huge hit single on it, and that single is already certified platinum or gold from streams. Because that single is on the album, sales of the whole album are now counted based on that stream number from the one single. So in actuality, people aren't necessarily downloading, buying, or streaming every song on the album, or buying the whole album together. They're streaming one particular song. This happens very often, and it's kind of misleading, because though it looks great on paper, for the publisher, for the publishing income for a producer or songwriter who aren't writers on a particular song that is huge, that has the bulk of the streaming, your revenue is not gonna be as high, obviously, because you didn't have as many streams of your song. So it's definitely misleading, and it's definitely caused mechanical royalties from record labels to take a dip down for music publishers. If you don't have a share of the biggest hit single on the album, your income's not gonna be as high as that particular song, yet the album is still certified platinum or gold. So it's a tricky scenario right there, and it has to be overhauled in Congress and, you know, on Capitol Hill in Washington. The physical product is not part of the album equivalent unit. Whenever you read in Billboard and you hear that so-and-so album sold 100,000 album equivalent units, that's the bundle of the streams, YouTube views, digital downloads, okay? And then whenever you see them say pure album sales, which is always less than what the album equivalent units, the pure album sales are the physical product. Pretty soon that won't exist. Physical product, unfortunately, is being phased out. Earlier this year, I believe it was like Target or Walmart, one of them said they were gonna no longer carry CDs. And when you go to Best Buy, the CD section is almost non-existent. So I would say CDs are pretty much a wrap, and that moving forward, it will be mostly album equivalent sales. But for now, as CDs still exist, you have the pure album sales number, and that is always the physical product. So normally when you're reading Billboard and you see the first week numbers on a big release, you'll see 200,000-300,000 album equivalent units, that's the bundle, and then you'll see 20,000 or 10,000 units in pure album sales, that's the physical. And that drastically affects mechanical royalty income from the record labels to the publishers and to the songwriters. It's a big difference between somebody going in the store and buying a CD or somebody streaming just one song on an album many, many times. The two major kind of publishing deals that exist are publishing administration deals and co-publishing deals, which also have administration rights in those deals. Okay, the big difference between the two is with an admin deal, the songwriter is basically bringing on a music publisher to help collect the revenue that's out there for them, and also to handle administration, which includes registering the songs with ASCAP, BMI, or CSAC, copywriting the songs with the U.S. Library of Congress, licensing the songs with the labels to collect the mechanical royalty income, okay? That's all part of administration, but the big difference with a co-pub deal is the songwriter is actually transferring half of the ownership in the composition to the publisher. That's why the publisher becomes the co-publisher in that agreement. Transfer of copyright is the biggest difference between co-publishing and administration deals. When it comes to collecting money from YouTube, SoundCloud, that income is usually embedded in your digital royalties from your album equivalent units through a mechanical royalty, or also a performance royalty from ASCAP, BMI, and CSAC. When you're a writer or publisher and you get your statements from ASCAP, BMI, or CSAC, they'll do a breakdown of Spotify plays, Pandora, and the rest. Sound Exchange is based in Washington, D.C. Sound Exchange royalties are not publishing royalties. So publishers do not normally collect those royalties. Sound Exchange royalties are called sound recording royalties. And they are payable only from Sound Exchange to featured artists or master owners and labels. So if you're a featured artist and you're, you know, you have a big catalog out there through Def Jam or through Sony, you can register for free, get set up with Sound Exchange directly, and receive your sound recording royalties. These sound recording royalties are collected only by Sound Exchange, and they come from satellite radio play. They come from digital radio play, like when you go onto Apple, when you go onto iTunes and you open up the different radio stations and you listen to whether it's classical music, hip hop, or whatever. When you listen to those different stations, Sound Exchange collects the Sound Exchange, the sound recording royalty from Apple and from Sirius Satellite Radio, XM as well.